Thank you. Wow. I'm an architect, but not an architect in a traditional sense. For example, I like to start out talking about mushrooms. So mushrooms to most people is a material that you really want to keep out of your buildings to avoid, I don't know, moisture damages, etc. But to me, I see a potential. Mushrooms have this kind of ability to actually grow. And as they're growing, the seeds of the mushroom are able to bind other materials together. So mushrooms could actually be tomorrow's building material, living on leftover materials from agricultural production. Actually, we could start to grow materials instead of building materials. So I think the point is that where normally other people are going in traditional material choices, I try to look into what science, what developments is finding place in biology, in chemistry, in physics. And for example, this example of mushrooms can be like grown materials, either structural, hard, soft, all a material that don't require energy in the making. That could be a potential future material. Well, I'm here today because my team is working with green innovation in architecture. Normally, as an architect, you spend today 90% of your time in front of your computer, working with yourself, design, developing, sketching. Well, then the other 10%, you might talk to other colleagues from your team, also architects. Well, we believe that innovation finds place when you meet people with other backgrounds, with other knowledge fields, from other industries. So that's why we have established a full-time research team that try to actively integrate other people. For example, in the current project we're working on, we're working with biologists, we're working with designers, with artists. In that way, we try to integrate knowledge, transfer knowledge into architecture to try to find that edge of where development has found place that actually can be transferred into architectural practice, which normally not is cutting edge. Cutting edge is medicine industry. It's an aeroplane industry. So that's where we try to find our inspiration. First project of three that I would like to talk about is this lawyer office. It's a headquarter based here in Copenhagen. It's sitting on the waterfront. In this project, we've worked particularly with the facade. We tried to create three things. We worked with this kind of three-dimensional sculptural expression in order to ensure the lawyers on the inside, who all have their own kind of cell offices due to all the privacy in their work. Well, they all have a kind of a spatial quality, a bay window viewing the ocean. Secondly, we are actually orientating the building in a way so the building creates sun shading as a part of this kind of sculptural expression. So in that way, the biggest challenge you have today in office buildings is overheating, to which you actually spend lots of energy to cool the building. So actually by working aesthetically with the kind of expression, we achieve to actually reduce the energy consumption of the building and also create this kind of mountain-like rich facade expression. But secondly, or thirdly, I think the main achievement, and also what I would like to talk about today, is actually the material choices. To create this building, we're looking, of course, on traditional concrete or steel structure, all very heavy due to all this kind of complex joints and movements in the facade. So we came up with looking at the windmill industry, taking a sandwich composite boards, what you normally know from surfboards. So we're working with this kind of a highly insulating foam that also creates kind of an energy coat for the building, as well as allows us to save 70% of the weight in the facade. And I think that's my talk today. My talk is about design, not as we know it. Normally we like refer to chair, objects, buildings. I like to go inwards, kind of talk about invisible design. How material science today is really developing at a rate that's spectacular. Every 10 months, you have twice the amount of knowledge within material science. I mean, it's a development rate that is remarkably close to that of the computer force. And all this knowledge allows us to design materials, not just talk about stone, wood, glass. Actually, materials has become a design object. Today, materials is more a question of what do I want to achieve with this material? How do I want the surface coating to be? How do I want the duration, the durability, the aesthetics, the environmental performance? And it's in that world that I like to kind of take you through my material world, talking about extreme materials, materials of tomorrow, materials of today. So the first material is spider silk, to whom you might know it's a very strong material. It performs like 50 times the strength of steel. The problem is, however, we know silk from silkworms, you can kind of mass produce that. You can't do that with spiders, they're aggressive. So they kind of attack each other and it doesn't work. So some guys in Canada has actually isolated the protein in spider silk, that's kind of the building stone, and then gene manipulated this into a mountain goat. So now today you can actually milk spider silk from mountain goats. that's not something that takes place in Europe yet. Second material, this is a kind of ultimative power material of tomorrow. This is nanotechnology. It's named carbon nanotube. Nanotechnology where you are actually able to bottom up, take each atom and arrange them in tubular structures, creating these very, very thin tubes that are performing 100 times as strong as steel. I mean, it's a very tiny scale. I mean, it takes 20,000 tubes to have the width of a human hair. But today already, you can start to grow these materials and you can mix them into composites, into steel, into rubber. I mean, and you create this kind of super performing materials that are allowing whole new expressions, volumes, dimensions in architecture. So the second project I'd like to share with you is it's a headquarter we're doing in Berlin. It's called The Cube. It was kind of the competition brief as well. So this was a challenge because our proposal is this kind of cube with four, you could even say five facades, including the roof, all made of glass. So how do you insulate glass? We wanted to work with the daylight, work with transparent insulation. So we looked into something called aerogel. Aerogel is actually an old school material invented in 1932. The thing about this is that it was used in NASA's space travels. It's extremely expensive materials, but in recent years, it's kind of dramatically developed or lowered in production costs. Now we can actually start to use this as architects. Aerogel is kind of a record holder in kind of material book of records. It's world's lightest material. It consists of 99.8% air. And that's a quality when you want to insulate. Because insulation, as we know it in mineral stone wool, that'll be rock wool, it's actually about trapping air, making it standing still. And this material does it inside the material on a molecular level. So it's also the best insulating material while it lets sunlight go through. On the outside of the glass, we would like to give something back to the city. Also working with self-cleaning glass. Glass that, when gets polluted, rinses off the dirt with the rainwater, but also when the sun hits the facade, it starts this chemical process that is cleaning the pollution in the center of Berlin. And doing this with all the facade, we're actually cleaning the surrounding air, equivalent to almost 500 trees. Inside, our client wants to have a steady indoor climate on 21 degrees, which is a very comfortable, pleasant working climate. So we are working with a ceiling that's plastered, and in this plaster mix, we're adding these small plastic capsules, and it's like a tenth the size of a sand grain. In each capsule, you have a paraffin that can change its phase. That means like water can change phase at 0 degrees. This paraffin, as you know from candles, is designed to change phase at 21 degrees. While doing it, all the heat is being accumulated in the material. In that way, we don't have expenses on air conditioning. So we're actually saving a lot of energy in terms of embedding this material in all the surface areas near to the heat in the building. So the building industry often is referred to as responsible for using half of the energy in the world. It's responsible for producing half the waste of the world. So what is that? What is waste? I mean, in nature, waste doesn't exist. I mean, waste is something that's man-made. Pollution is something that's man-made. In nature, everything has a purpose for something else. So I think the design challenge is to eliminate the concept of waste, talking about life cycle design. So this leads me to the third project, which is a green school we're doing in Stockholm, a school where our client envisions teaching the kids with modern way of agriculture. So it's an agricultural high school in which there also are dormitories, elderly living, whole food stores, and of course all the student environment with learning environments. So in this project, we're really working with the living materials. For example, the past 2 years, we've been collecting wild seeds from nature in order to produce wild plants. Why do we want to do that? Well, on all our walls, our roofs, our kind of outdoor surfaces, we want to actually let the building integrate into the surrounding biotopes. So actually having developed this catalog of wild plant species, we are able to mimic the local biotopes of the surrounding area in all the Nordic regions. Inside, we want to illustrate how modern agricultural techniques can triple, quadruple, actually, when it comes to strawberries particularly enough, you can actually harvest with a harvest rate of 10. So each month, it's actually possible to harvest strawberries in these hanging gardens. Lower in the building, of course, we have more like upscale production, working with hydroponic, aeroponics. In the facade, we're using algae as solar shading. And algae as solar shading, it's really interesting because you can like start with a kind of pale glass in the morning, and then when the sun rises, the algae production starts to develop, and you can time it to actually match the shading need you have during the day. This, of course, generates a lot of heat in the water in which the algae are flowing, heat we can use for the building. Also, the algae as a biomass we can use to burn that to actually heat our flooring in the building. So I think that's kind of my vision. Why should architecture always be pointed out as a part of the problem? I mean, it could be part of the solution. I mean, I envision buildings where you actually are producing air, buildings that are eating CO2, buildings where the roots of the plants can actually purify the water, buildings where materials and uses the developments in material science to actually design materials so they can be fully recycled and into biological or technical circles. Buildings that is producing energy. Buildings that is kind of integrating with nature where people can thrive and in a way actually become a man-made ecosystem. So that's my vision. Thank you.